This morning, I have an awesome opportunity to share with you from the Word of God. We are in the middle of our explicit series. If you are joining us for the first time, welcome. I am Pastor Teresa, and I co-pastor this campus with my husband, Pastor Glenn. And last week, thank you, Jesus, I got a get-out-of-jail card and didn't have to talk about sex. He did it. Praise the Lord. The Lord loves me. And I'm like, Lord, I don't want to talk about sex. Let Glenn do that. But I absolutely want to talk about raising children, because I am extremely, extremely passionate about raising children, obviously, because I have five. So if you're visiting and you don't know, I do have five children. I know I don't look like I have five children. I look good, yeah? The Lord ages you well. But my oldest is 21, and my youngest is going to be 1 year old this year. This month. So I'm excited to share with you from the Word of God. So we're going to jump right into it. I want you to take out your notes. Because Rich already plugged the last element, and I know some of you have to work, now I have all this pressure to finish on time. But don't worry, I talk really fast, okay? Glenn and I have had the awesome privilege of being parents now to five wonderful children for more than some 20 years. And as we reflect on all those years of parenting, we truly have realized one truth. There is no such thing as perfect parenting. Turn to your neighbor and say, it doesn't exist. Turn to your other neighbor and say, be free. You don't got to be perfect. Hallelujah. However, I do believe that the Holy Spirit has guided us through this very important ministry of raising our children. And today, I hope to be able to share some of the wisdom we've gained through the mentoring of the Holy Spirit and those that the Lord brought along our side, because, you know, we didn't do it alone. Proverbs 22:6 says this, and let's read it together. Ready? And go. Train up a child in the way he should go. Even when he is old, he will not depart from it. Okay, every parent wants for their children to follow the Lord in the ways of the Lord when they are older. Can I get an amen? I don't know any parent who says, oh, I want my kid to grow up and, like, be a juvenile delinquent, or I want my child to grow up and, like, end up being in prison. Nobody says that. Every parent wants their child to grow up. If they are a believer themselves, they want their children to follow after the Lord. Amen? The magic question every parent asks is, well then, okay, if I train up my child in the ways that they should go, they will not depart from it. How do I train them up? How do I train them up? Now, before I get into this, let me say that this is not perfect. Every child is different. And that's why this is a hard question to answer, because there is no cookie cutter answer. There is no, if you do A, B, C, D, E, F, G, then for sure your child will follow in the ways of the Lord. What I will tell you is that if you stick to some of these principles we're going to share today, you can trust that the Lord has them. Can I get an amen? I know from my parents, they raised me up in the things of God. But when I went to college, I went wayward. They didn't fail me as a parent. I just got a taste of freedom and went kind of crazy. You know, so for those of you that are graduating, Alyssa, you're going to go to college, and let me tell you, the devil is going to come, and he's going to be watchful, and he's going to find the opportune time to tempt you. But I pray that today you remember some of these truths, and these truths will help you overcome in those areas. Can I get an amen? Okay? So although there is no cookie cutter answer, there are some basic and consistent truths that we can see in the Bible that that can help us parents, because every child is different. They require unique parenting. But one truth which might be the most important truth, okay? The one truth which might be the most important truth is that we are called to write your notes. Number one, shepherd our child's heart. Shepherd our child's heart. Shepherd our children's heart. Okay? Proverbs 4:23 says this. Let's read it together. Ready and go. Guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life. Okay, I want you to circle the word heart. And I want you to circle the word determines. So what determines the course of your life? Your heart. So if we know that the heart determines the course of our children's life, then we're not after just targeting their head and giving them a bunch of head knowledge. We want to get into their heart. Are you with me? And I think what we do sometimes as parents is we try to teach our kids a bunch of stuff that they keep in their mind, but then the heart goes left unshepherded. And when they go away from home, it's out of their heart that determines which course their life will go, not all the information that we gave them as parents. Are you with me? So as parents, we don't want to simply tell our children what they can and cannot do. We want to shepherd their hearts to learn how to discern what they should do because of what they know is truth in the Word of God. It all starts with shepherding their heart. And so I want to focus and give you three keys. Now, there may be many keys to unlock your child's heart. But I found over the years, as I prayed, you know, many people come up to Glenn and I and ask us, how did you parent? How did you do this? How did you do that? And honestly, we really had no clue how we did it. If I had to be transparent with you, every day was a new day in grace. Can I get an amen? And I was just holding on to Jesus with dear life, like, please, God, help me figure this out. I never wanted kids. I knew I would be a terrible mother. I'm like, why would anybody want to give me kids? I would not be a good steward of that. And God had a different plan. So because I knew that I was not strong in the area of parenting, I held on to Jesus and the Holy Spirit with dear life. So I did not really know what it was we did until I went into prayer. I had to ask the Lord, God, show me what it is we did. I don't know what we did because you told me what to do every day. And so once he told me it, I did it, and then I forgot about it. You know, you start the next day, you do it, and you forget. You're not like taking tallies. I wished I would have wrote it all down in a journal because then I would have my first published book already by now. But I didn't. So in prayer, God showed me three keys that unlocked my children's heart. Like I said, there are going to be many. For me, I think these are three that will resonate to many of us here this morning. So key number one, write in your notes, listen to learn. Listen to learn. Turn to your neighbor and say, listen to learn. We must learn what is truly going on in the hearts of our children in order to know how to direct their paths. Can I get an amen? If you don't know what's going on with them, you're not going to know how to guide them. The only way to know what's going on with them is to listen. If we know how they are struggling on the inside of their hearts, then we'll know how to minister to where they're hurting in their heart. Okay? Luke chapter 6, this is not in your notes, write it in the margin. Luke chapter 6, verse 45 teaches, a good person produces good things from the treasury of a good heart. An evil person produces evil things from the treasury of an evil heart. And here it is. What you say flows from what is in your heart. If you want to know what's going on in your child's heart, listen to what they're saying. This is true for anybody that you're mentoring. Maybe you're not a parent here, but you're a spiritual mentor of many. Or maybe you're going to embark on becoming a spiritual mentor. If you want to know how to help your person that you're mentoring and coaching grow, get them to talk. Immediately you'll start to see what's in their heart. And that's where you want to bring Jesus to minister to, is whatever's going on in their heart. We listen to what they speak, but we can also listen to what's being said through their body language, right? As parents, we know body language, yeah? When they give you the attitude, right? Or in my house, it's the sad face. You get the sad puppy dog face, and immediately I'm like, oh, somebody's upset. I know something's going on. Okay? If we ask enough questions, we will eventually listen to learn the inner root issue causing the outer bad fruit. We can uproot bad fruit and replace it with God's good fruit as soon as we hear what the bad fruit is. Now, key, if you're listening, and I had to learn this the hard way, and I'm still learning this. If you're listening, you don't want to automatically jump on the bad fruit and start telling people what the bad fruit is. Okay? I have a prophetic gift, so sometimes I'm like 10 steps ahead of the people that I'm working with. That's actually can be very bad. It's not, it should be good for me, you know, and helping others. But because I'm 10 steps ahead, I want to just give them the answer. There is no greater power to transform a person's life than self-revelation. That's the key to transformation. You want them to have a revelation for themselves. You don't want to have to tell them. Now, if they don't get a revelation, at some point you got to tell them. Can I get an amen? You don't let them walk around blind forever. You try your best to get them to see it by asking questions. You're asking questions, and each question is leading them to the foot of Jesus so that Jesus himself can tell them. But if they don't get there, you kind of got to steer them and give them some help. Can I get an amen? Okay, you don't want to just listen to what they're saying and not saying in their nonverbal communication when they're talking with you. I found that the greatest information I got from my kids is when they were talking to each other. All kinds of truth comes out of their mouth when they're talking to each other. See, now kids, they don't think that you're paying attention. But as a mom, you can hear everything. I could be cooking dinner and they can be in their room and I don't know the whole thing that's happening. I'm like, oh, that's interesting. Okay, praise Jesus. You know what I mean? That's how I found out most of everything that's going on in my kids' life was listening to their conversations to each other. I knew when Misha had her first crush. I knew when Brayden was all up in like serious about some person because of them talking to each other. I'm like, oh, okay, I need to kind of see myself into that conversation. And you don't barge in there. You just start to ask questions. And then they invite you into that conversation. Amen? Once they begin to answer questions that you're asking them, you just listen, and then you let the Holy Spirit lead you to another question. Then you let the Holy Spirit lead you to another question until you get to the root issue. Okay? And once you get to the root issue, here's the key. You got to then ask the Holy Spirit, what do I do about it? Okay, Holy Spirit, what do I do about it for this child? Because every child is different. So I may be able to come across more strong with one child than I can with the other child. Okay? But if you ask enough questions in love, you know, and I've learned this over the course of time, your tone matters. Your tone matters. I'm improving on my tone, right, Giselle? Instead of sounding like a drill sergeant, I'm sounding a little more nice and loving. But if you ask enough loving questions, you'll get to what's going on in their heart, and more importantly, you'll get to the truth. If you get to the truth, you can set them free. Amen? Key number two, laugh to live. Laugh to live. This is an area that I learned from my husband. I am not a jokester. I rarely get jokes. If you say a joke, I'll be the last person in the room to get the joke. I'm a prophet and I'm a preacher. I am a prophet and a preacher, and I take everything serious because I'm all about the things of God, so everything is serious. And I don't know how to laugh, and I don't know how to joke around, and Glenn will say something, and I'll get all upset that he said it, and I'll turn to the kids, and they'll say, Mom don't know how to take a joke, yeah? No, I don't. I'm learning how to take a joke. In all honesty, I realized that Glenn and I were a perfect match because I was always about shepherding their hearts and listening and spiritually speaking into situations. I mean, you ask the kids, I was always preaching at them about some truth in the Bible that applied to some situation or a movie or anything else. I mean, if I could apply spiritual truth to everything we were doing, I did it because that's just how my brain works. But Glenn, he is so soft and loving, he brought in the laughter. And I'm telling you, without that laughter, it probably would not have been a healthy house for my children because they would always just been corrected and being trained and taught and trained and taught, and then they would have never got laughter. There would have never been the bonding between parent and child. We got that because we laughed all the time. My husband would play ridiculous games. My husband, to make laughter, and I'm probably going to expose him right now. I love you, sweetheart, wherever you are. I love you, honey. I'm just going to share your laughter with the rest of the church. And he doesn't do this to be gross, but he does these things because he knows it'll make us laugh. We'll all be in the living room watching some serious show or having a serious conversation. He'll walk by and he'll stop in front of one of the kids and he'll fart. And I'm just like, oh, man, you know what I mean? And then he'll laugh. He'll laugh. Everybody is laughing. Let me tell you, church, if you really want to get after your kid's heart, you need to fill your homes with laughter. That was something my husband, don't come ask me how to do it. I'm confessing to you all, I did not make my kids laugh. They were not laughing because I made them laugh. They were laughing at me. The joke was always on mom. And I'm okay with that. I had a healthy self-image. And I knew the Father's love that I was okay with the joke being always on mom. If it made my kids laugh, go on and laugh at me. I'm all right with that. It's okay. Because it brought us closer together. Okay, scripture tells us in Proverbs chapter 17, verse 22. It's not your notes. You're going to have to write in a margin. Proverbs chapter 17, verse 22. A cheerful heart is good medicine, but a broken spirit saps a person's strength. You need to be cheerful. You know, I heard one man say, are you excited? Are you happy about life? And the person would be like, yeah. And then the man would say, well, tell your face that. Laugh a bit. Smile. Okay. We know it's hard in the world. But if you don't get yourself cheerful, if you don't fill yourself up with the joy of the Lord and laugh a little bit and be able to laugh at yourself, I mean, that's the greatest gift my husband gave me. And he taught me how to laugh at myself, and I did. I laugh at myself all the time. I look at some of the things that I've done, and I'm just like, oh, my gosh. I say words that they don't even exist. I make up words. I'm just like, did I just say that? I think I just made up a new word. And I just laugh. You know, they laugh at my pictures because I'm so intense. True story. Let me tell you, we have some amazing photographers in the house, so this is not anything on them. We have amazing photographers in the house of God. Just go look at the photos. I am just terrible to take photos of. If you have a knack for taking photos, man, and you can get a good photo of me, hallelujah, praise the Lord to you, because I am an intense person. I'm intense, and I'm always, poor Kurt, I'm always intense. So photos of me always look like, it's crazy. Go on our Instagram. You want a good laugh, go on the Instagram and just look up every picture of Pastor Teresa. You will get yourself a belly full, okay? And so every Sunday, that's how we laugh in my house. They're like, let's go look at the photos of mom, because they know it's going to be ridiculous. Not because of the people taking photography, just because of how I am. I make these weird facial expressions. It's crazy. Misha's trying to train me, mom, you have to put the happy face on. And I'm like, I can't get no happy face. I'm rolling with the Holy Spirit. I'm not looking at my face. So anyways, y'all can pray for me because it's funny. But the bottom line is we use it all to laugh. We use it all to laugh. I love how this contemporary English version says it. Same verse. If you are cheerful, you feel good. If you are sad, you hurt all over. Can I get amen? Amen. Laughter is going to make you feel good. Learn how to laugh. Learn how to get a sense of humor. Like I said, that doesn't come naturally to everybody. It didn't come naturally to me. I had to learn how to laugh. Okay? Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 4 tells us there's a time to cry and there's a time to laugh. If you want to get at your child's heart, you cannot just constantly be correcting them. If you're constantly correcting them, constantly correcting them, constantly correcting them, and there is no laughter in your home, that makes for a bad, 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 bad. Because then they start to get bitter, not better. They get bitter, not better. Okay? If you're not a person that can crack jokes and laugh and fart in your kid's face, that's okay. Do a movie night every once in a while. That's a fun movie that, you know, like my kids have movies that they like. We used to watch movies with them. We just let them pick whatever movie they wanted, and we would laugh at the movie with them, even if I thought the movie was ridiculously boring. Now that they're older, I won't do that anymore. I'm like, no. When Emma is a little older, I have to revert now. I'm going to have to learn to watch some of these movies again. Okay, but you get into your kids' world and laugh with them. Key number 3. Love to lead. Love to lead. Now, this seems like a no-brainer, right? Love to lead. But the kind of loving I want to share with you this morning, it comes from John chapter 15, verse 13. And it says, there is no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friend. Okay? Brothers and sisters, It may not matter as much when they're younger, but when they start to hit middle school, kids notice things. They notice everything. And the kind of love that will speak greatly to them is sacrificial love. It's the love that says, I'm too busy, I have everything on me, but you know what? That is not as important as you. What do you need from me? It's the kind of love that is, I have a mountain of things to do, but spending quality time and having this conversation and getting into your world and how was school today, you know, what are you struggling with? You look like you got a lot on your mind. We ask that question all the time. I ask Brayden, you look like you have a lot on your mind. He just started a brand new job. I'm watchful. He doesn't have to say anything. I just know my child. And Brayden, out of everybody in our house, is happy-go-lucky. He's joyful. He is always up and bubbly. And lately, he's been real quiet and contemplative. And so I would ask him, Brayden, you look like you got a lot on your heart. Help me help you. You got to talk it out, Brayden. You got to talk it out. He said, Mom, I don't even know how to articulate what I'm feeling. And I said, it's okay. Let's figure it out together. So when they have no words, I start him with words, and eventually he'll get to his own words. Do you see what I'm saying? But all of that takes time. You know, I got a newborn in our house. The other day, I yelled at Emmett. Believe it or not, he's not even 1 year old. I yelled at him, and I just the kids laughed. They laughed. I'm like, you're not my only child. Because he was like all on me, and I was trying to have a real deep conversation with Brayden. You know, and I'm like, son, you're going to learn. Like, you're not the only child here. The world does not revolve around Emmett. He's going to learn, right? And so, but all of that takes sacrifice. It takes patient endurance, right? Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Love is patient. Love is kind. If you want to get to your kid's heart, man, you got to grow in the patience factor. When they were young, that was an area that I did not do well. It's funny how that works. When they were younger, I was less patient. Glenn was more patient. Now that they're older, I am more patient and Glenn is less patient. But yeah, they'll agree. They're on my side with that. The kids will say, amen, mama. but it's okay. It's all good. All I want to say with that illustration is that nobody's perfect. We all need each other. You know, husbands and wives, you need each other. And later on, you're going to see we need more than just each other. Okay? But love is patient and it's kind. Love is not jealous, it's not boastful, it's not proud. It doesn't demand its own way. You know, yes, we want to tell our children how we're going to live in our house, but we were always open to listening to what the kids were going through and trying to adjust. We bring value to them. When we say, okay, I understand where you're coming from. I understand where you're coming from, but this is where mom and dad's coming from. It was a dialogue between our children. And I'm talking obviously when they're older. When they were younger, it was mom's way or the highway. There's no negotiation. I'm the boss, right? But when they're older, like they hit middle school, that's when you really want to start shepherding their heart. Yeah, Glenn said when they were younger, it was a benevolent dictatorship. We say you do. But when they get older, how many of you know that dictatorship don't work? Because what happens is they rebel. So then your parenting needs to switch. You need to start shepherding more of the heart. You want to reason with them a little bit more. Tip, do not reason with your young ones. Don't. Kids would ask us questions. If they were in elementary school, I mean, they were like 6 and younger, you know, 7, 8. They would ask us questions, and Glenn and I would make up the ridiculous answers. I mean, we would make up stupid answers. Because they would ask us questions just to irritate us. So we figured it out, and we'd be in the car, and they would ask us questions, and I would say, because elephants are purple and cows jump through the sky, and it would silence them. Because they would be like, huh? We didn't negotiate with our young ones. We didn't, like, try and reason with them. They don't have the maturity to reason. Are you with me? Once they hit middle school and they're starting to learn to think for themselves, maybe 5th grade, you know, like, Riley probably like 5th grade going into middle school. That's right there is when you want to start shepherding their heart. You want to get into the heart. You don't want to just tell them anymore. You want to help them to discover. Okay? Theodore Roosevelt said it like this. People don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. That is true for our children. Our children, when they get older, they don't even care how much you're talking at them. They want to know truly how much you care about them. And parents, sometimes we say we don't care about you because we make everything in our lives more important than what's going on in their lives. Glenn and I never did that. We never, ever, ever, ever tried to make our stuff more important than them. We just stopped all other activity to make sure we were involved with them. If they were going to be in Taekwondo, I was going to be at Taekwondo. I was the non-don black belt in Taekwondo. That's the joke, meaning I don't do Taekwondo, but yet I'm a black belt, non-don. Okay? No one laughed at my joke. See? I'm not funny. It's okay. I'm confident in the Lord. I'm secure in Jesus Christ. But I would go and I would be in their world. I would learn everything there is to know about their pumses, and I would memorize it myself, even though I wasn't taking the class, because I wanted to be in their world. That was the only way for me to connect with my kids. Now, I'm not saying completely live your whole life around your children. We didn't do that either. I have some parents that tell me, how did you get involved with ministry with your kids? How did you get them to church? That wasn't a negotiation. I didn't say, okay, we'll go to church when you're ready to get up. I said, get up. We're going to church. There was no discussion about that. You know, we didn't let them whine and complain, you know. If they weren't going to get out of the bed, we was going to get us a water gun and start shooting some kids with some water until they woke up and was going to church, right? So I'm not saying live your whole life around your child, but I am saying live sacrificially enough to be in their world. What are they into? I remember my kids, they went through a season of playing video games. They don't play anymore because they're grown up now, so they don't have much time to play. But I wasn't about to do video games. Glenn tried so many times. Honey, come on, play this war game with me. I'm like, honey, I don't play that game. I don't do video. I can't do it. But he got into it. And I was so thankful he did. Because then I knew he could get into their world. A place I couldn't get into, right? And that's all love. Love is time to children. You got to give them time. If you're not going to give them time, they don't care about how much you're telling them with your mouth that you love them. Believe me, I love you, but yet you won't spend any time with your kid. No, you don't. To them, time, love is spelled T-I-M-E. That's how love is spelled with kids. And you got to give it to them. And I'm here to tell you, if you keep telling yourself, oh, someday I'll give them time. Someday I'll give them time. Someday I'll give them time. If I just get this, this, and this, and this done, then I'll give them time. That is not going to work. That's going to come back and it's going to bite you. I have seen kids rebel because of that. I had one kid, not in this fellowship, but in Mililani, when we were way back in the time, 10 years ago, when we were in Mililani. This child never had any time with his parents. Long story short, thank God that his hand is on our children. And you pray for God's hand to be on the children. This child was thinking of suicide. Nobody knew. The only reason why they found out was because he reached out to Pastor Mark. When Pastor Mark wasn't even a pastor, really. He was just getting started in ministry. And all of a sudden, red flags. Near, 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 near. You know what? That red flag should have never happened. If they were spending quality time with that child when he was younger, they would have known what that kid was going through. Okay? And I'm not saying that to beat up on parents. I know how challenging it is. And that there is no perfect parent out there. This is why I'm so excited to give this message. But I'm just trying to give you some keys that will unlock your kid's heart, because some parents, they're trying to shepherd their kid, and the kid is all, like, locked up. Maybe the key is just going to make them laugh some. Maybe it's going to be show them that you really love them. Spend some quality time with them. Maybe you need to listen more. Ask more questions. Stop talking at your child. Talk with your child. You see the difference? Okay? So, number one, you need to shepherd your child's heart. Number two, write in your notes, we inoculate our children with truth. We inoculate our children with truth. John chapter 8, verses 31 to 32 says this. Jesus said to the people who believed in him, "You are truly my disciples if you remain faithful to my teachings, and you will know the truth, and the truth shall set you free." Everybody knows this scripture, okay? But the key here is you remain faithful to that truth. Then the truth will set you free. You don't just know the truth, it's applied truth sets you free. Turn to your neighbor and say, "Applied truth sets you free." Okay? What does inoculate mean? Inoculate in the Bible and in the dictionary says, you treat a person or an animal with a vaccine to produce immunity against a disease. So when I say we're inoculating our children with truth, we are filling them so much with truth that when they go into a disease-infested world, they are not affected by it. I have a true story. When my kids were young, Harry Potter came out. Raise your hand if you know Harry Potter. Okay? Raise your hand if you read all the Harry Potter books. Oh, hallelujah for you all. Oh, I tried. Couldn't get through the book. That's a big book. Okay? So, our kids were younger when Harry Potter came out. And I remember the commotion that thing caused in the church. We had mothers in church talking to pastors about how no Christian child should ever watch those movies and they shouldn't be forced to read the books. I mean, they were going on and on and on because it's about witchcraft and blah, 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 blah. And I'm like thinking, what the heck is going on? Like, what is Harry Potter, you know? And so my husband and I went home like, honey, what is Harry Potter? What's going on with the Harry Potter? This woman went off on me. I was at Walmart. And this woman went off on me about her strong convictions about she would never let her child watch Harry Potter because they were showing the movie Harry Potter on the videos at Walmart, and she was scolding her child profusely in public because he was watching Harry Potter on the TV. And I'm like looking at this child, and he's like, it was not good. And so I went home, and I'm like, honey, is there something you and I are missing here? Are we missing something? It's just a movie, you know? And he said, well, let's watch it. So we waited for the kids to go to sleep, and like at midnight, he woke me up. Come on, it's time to watch the movie. He woke me up. True story. Woke me up. We turned on the video, him and I in the living room midnight watching this Harry Potter. It was the greatest movie ever. It was so entertaining. Now, hear me. Hear my heart, people. Hear me. I'm not saying that there's not any dangers behind that movie because they make witchcraft, wizardry. They make it look fun. This is what I want to teach you. You don't have to curse all that stuff and try and guard your children, protect them, keep them away from it. You need to inoculate them with truth. So when they see a movie like that, they know the evil behind what that represents. So we sat our kids down and we said, okay, we're going, because they all wanted to watch Harry Potter. They were like, mommy, everybody watching it at school, man. Oh, mommy, I want to watch it. Daddy, how come we got? I'm like, oh, God. Okay, so we had them all sit down. Okay, sit down, children, sit down. We're going to watch Harry Potter together, but you need to know some truth. The reason why people are upset about this movie is because there is such a thing as Wiccan. And Wiccan is witchcraft. And Wiccan is of the devil's work. There is evil and there is good in the world. And so they are making fun of this evil thing and they're making it a kids' movie. But we started to teach them truth about, yes, this is a movie, but know that there is this evil in the world. And so now they're like, they watched all of Harry Potter. They are not into witchcraft. They don't have soul ties. They don't need to be delivered. They don't, because we inoculated them with truth. Are you with me? You cannot shelter your kids from the things of the world. You cannot shield them from ever seeing pornography. For goodness sakes, even if you turn on the family channel, they're talking about condoms. And I remember Giselle was little and Michael was older. We were Family Network, and they had a condom commercial, and Giselle said, what's a condom? And Michael's like, you don't need to know what that is. I looked at Mike and we both started rolling, and Giselle was like, okay. I don't even know how old she was. What I'm trying to tell you is you cannot hide it from them. It is everywhere. It is everywhere. You want to inoculate them with truth so that they're not affected by the diseases of the world. Are you with me? How do you inoculate them with truth? Well, that's Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 through 9. That's the Shema that we teach in our church. Right? Listen, O Israel, the Lord is our God. The Lord alone is our God. You need to teach your children how to make God number one in their life. Every time you see something that gets in the way of their relationship with God, it's an idol. Show them how that is taking away from their relationship with God. And it says, and you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your strength. And you must commit yourselves wholeheartedly to these commands that I am giving you today. Repeat them again and again to your children. Talk about them when you're at home and when you're on the road, when you're going to bed and when you're getting up. Tie them to your hands and wear them on your forehead as reminders. Write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. I can go on and on about the Shema. I'm not going to. The bottom line is, how do you inoculate your kids with truth? You give them truth as you live life. You're going to Walmart. You see something. Speak truth. You're watching TV, you see something, you speak truth to it. You bring in the Word of God. Most importantly, how do you inoculate your kids with truth? You be living truth. I'm telling you, the thing that will turn kids away like that is hypocrisy. We have a whole generation of people that are high school and middle, like young adult college age kids now. They grew up in the church, they went to youth program, they went to youth camps, they went to college, immediately they walked away from the Lord because they saw hypocrisy. And so the enemy planted a lie in their head. Everything you were raised in is not true. So they walk away. You, as a person, needs to be a living truth. John Maxwell talks about how Jesus had a great idea. I-D-E-A, idea. I-D-E-A. Jesus had a great idea on how to model this leadership, this spiritual leadership to people. Number one, instruction. He verbally taught his disciples. He constantly used daily routines to instruct his disciples. Use daily routines to instruct your children. D, demonstration. He modeled truth for them. He let the people he was trying to disciple observe his life. Basically, Jesus did show and tell. You want your children to walk in truth and be inoculated in truth? Let them watch you be inoculated in truth. You live the truth. He gave them experience. He let the disciples participate and apply the truth to themselves. Allow for your children to experience truth with you. People ask us all the time, do you shield your kids from what's going on in church? Nope. We do not. If something happens in church publicly and the kids go home and say, what the heck was that, Mom? Me and Glenn, we sit them down and we talk about it. We allow for them to experience truth in that. Because if we don't process that with them, they're going to find somebody else to process it with, and they may not get truth. Can I get an amen? Which leads me to the last great idea, A, assessment. Debrief your experiences with your children. Debrief everything. We debrief everything. We debrief outgoings. We debrief church. We debrief ministry. We debrief going to movies. You know, any opportunity to debrief what's going on in our kids' head, we did it. We started asking questions and we debriefed. We have now entitled some of our debriefing meetings are called shawarma. And the kids will say, Mom, Dad, we need shawarma. If you don't know what shawarma is, you didn't watch all the way to the end of the trailers of Avengers. Because in the movie Avengers, all the superheroes, they shawarma. They went to shawarma, yeah, the sandwich shop. And they're like hamas. They're sitting around the table and they're all hamas, silent, just eat sandwich. And sometimes life beats us down, and so kids are like, we need shawarma. That is their code word to Mom and Dad. We need to go out to eat. We need to sit around the table, and we don't need to talk about it. We just need to be together because it was a rough week. Okay? But we gave them permission to talk to us like that. We didn't shield them from anything. Okay? Lastly, number three, write in your notes. We shepherd our children's heart. We inoculate them with truth. And then number three, remember, it takes a village to raise one child. Remember, it takes a village to raise one child. Now, disclaimer. This is not biblical. It does not say anywhere in the Bible it takes a village to raise a child. What it does say is in Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 12, and that's in your notes, it says, a person standing alone can be attacked and defeated, but two can stand back to back and conquer. Three are even better, for a triple braided cord is not easily broken. Turn to your neighbor and say, triple braided cord. So where does it takes a village come from? It's actually an African proverb. It's an African proverb that basic meaning is that child upbringing is a communal effort. In Africa, they believe raising children is a communal, it's a community effort. The responsibility for raising a child is shared with the larger family. What is our larger family? It is the body of Christ. So if there is one thing Glenn and I did right, is we let the larger family help us raise our children. When we were in EK, before we were pastors, it was by faith that we raised our children. Glenn and I were always on stage doing ministry because we were in charge of all of the performing arts, doing specials, everything. Children's Ark wasn't even open by the time we had to start ministering. So Micah had to watch all of our little children, as young as they were, and we prayed a protection over them. God, please don't let them like leave the campus. Keep them safe. But we also knew that our family of God knew that we were on stage, and if they were going to be in trouble, somebody would step in for us. We knew that if they were stepping out of alignment, some auntie somewhere was going to scold them. I don't think your mom and dad want you doing that. More importantly, I don't think the Lord wants you doing that. And that's what the village did for us. And I can't tell you how many times the village stepped in to help us parent. I remember we already shared with you Giselle's issues with her anger, which is amazing. This is a testimony to the Lord's work. She is the least angry in our house. But she had major anger issues when she was younger, and I'm on stage. She's in Children's Ark, and she's having issues at Children's Ark now. And one of the Children's Ark teacher came to me and said, Teresa, I don't know what to do. This is what happened. I said, you know, it was Lay O'Lion. It was Lay O'Lion. And I said, I know, you know, Lay, we're trying to work with her. She has such high expectations of everybody around her. And then when they don't meet those expectations, she gets really frustrated. I said, Lay, I give you permission. Speak into her. Speak into her. It's okay. And Auntie Lay did, yeah, through Children's Ark. So we were speaking into her at home. Lay was speaking into her at Children's Ark. And together as a village, we broke her from her anger issues and her frustration with other people. And now she walks in the peace of Christ all the time. Hallelujah. So, but you have to allow yourself to let the village help you. How many of us know that it's easy to try and battle on your own? Been there, done that. Let me tell you from experience, it is so much better to battle with some friends. Can I get an amen? I remember one time, I won't share what happened, but another one of my children were like really being attacked big time by the enemy. And the Lord showed me what was going on, and I was like, no, not on my watch. I have never been so angry in all of my life. I have never, this one thing, if I could have went out and beat up some demons, that was the day. Because I was like, not on my watch, not on my watch. So when I told you, you don't tell your child what's going on, because the Holy Spirit showed you. I walked up to this child in the kitchen as we were preparing breakfast, and I said, is there something you want to share with me? And that's all it took. And that child came undone and started to share what was in their heart. And I listened, and I prayed, and I spoke truth into it. But I knew that this battle was fierce and it was far from over. Immediately, I kept myself together. I went to my husband. I said, I need you and I need you now. Close the door. It's time to battle. And I told my husband what was going on, and he immediately was like, that ain't, nope. We come against that. And the very next person I called was Pastor Mike. And I cried. I said, Pastor Mike, this cannot happen. I will not let this happen in my house. He said, Teresa, it's because the enemy has an assignment on your family. I said, he picked the wrong family. And immediately, Pastor Mike went into battle with us. We were praying like no one's business together. He called me the next week. How are we doing? We need to keep praying. He called me. How are we doing? We need to keep praying. Pastor Mike, I am not going to cease until this is over. The enemy will not conquer this family. But I allowed for that issue to be exposed and for the family to come around. I'm not saying go and tell everybody in this church your business. I'm not saying that. But you better find one, two, three people that you can turn to so that we battle together. And you don't give up until we have the victory. Why? Because God promises the victory. It doesn't matter what the circumstance looks like. We have victory in him. Amen? But you have to let the village help you. A triple braided cord cannot be broken. What is your triple braided cord? Well, number one, it's you, the parents. Number two, it's the Holy Spirit. A lot of people will say it's Jesus. You don't talk to Jesus, you're talking to the Holy Spirit. Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father. He sent the Holy Spirit to be our comforter, to be our guider, to be our counselor, to be our teacher. So if you're not comfortable with Holy Spirit, we need to get you comfortable with Holy Spirit. You need to meet Holy Spirit, you need to embrace Holy Spirit, and you need to let Holy Spirit be your friend. Because Holy Spirit is one of your braids. The third braid in your triple braided cord is the church. It's the church. And you have to allow yourself to let the church come alongside you. You see, I think what happens is the enemy wants you to feel embarrassed. He tries to convince you, like, oh, they're going to judge you if they know that this is going on in your family. Why do you think he wants you to feel that way? Because he doesn't want you talking to nobody. Because then he knows you're going to be strengthened by the other brothers and sisters in the church. But if he can make you feel shame, which is what he made Adam and Eve feel when they messed up in the garden, he can isolate you, and if he can isolate you, he can take you out. You can't allow that to happen. There is a fierce battle for families, especially righteous ones. And we have to band together as a village to raise these children. Can I get an amen? One last thing I want to share. I'm talking about families and I'm talking about children, but these truths apply to everybody in the house of God. If you are here today and you are single, stand to your feet. I'm not going to have you stand forever. Stand to your feet. Stand up. Look around at how many single people we have here. Okay. If you're here today and you don't even have children, keep standing to your feet. Yeah, you ain't got no children. Okay, look at all these people. Let me tell you, you guys want to know my philosophy? Here it is in a nutshell. I don't care if you're widowed. I don't care if you're single. I don't care if you're a single parent. I don't care if you ain't got no kids. I don't care. I don't care what demographic you fall in. You are a part of this family. And we deny everybody in our family. And if the enemy is coming after one of you, we are all going to rise up in battle for you. Can I get an amen? Now, I'm here to say that publicly because, yes, we have a family ministry, and that's how God uniquely designed us. But know my heart, our family ministry transcends our children. I cannot tell you how many families we have denied, especially military families, into our family. We're not just about our children and raising our children. I disciple a lot of people, you know, and I'm trying to narrow that down. I mean, Jesus only had 12. I got to make sure if Jesus, the Son of God, only had 12, that tells you something. Only a human being can only handle so many people. You know what I mean? But I don't want anybody to come into the house of God and not feel a part of the village. Everybody is a part of the village, and we all need each other. And so in closing, we have prepared for you a special song. And I love this song. When I first heard this song, I heard it at my kids' high school choir concert. And I heard this song, and it just touched my heart. It moved me so much that it has never left me. Because to me, it takes a village. Is God's desire for the house of God. What the lyrics of this song declare is the Lord's heart for the house of God. And basically it says it takes a whole village to raise our children. It takes a whole village to raise one child. Whether you're a parent with children or not, every single person sitting in this room is a child. We are all children of God. It takes a whole village to raise a child of God. Can I get an amen? So it takes a whole village to raise one child. It says, what's the rest of it? We all, everyone, must share the burden. We all, everyone, will share the joy. And in a nutshell, that's what the house of God is all about. In a nutshell, that's what our ministry out here is all about. So we're going to sing this song a couple of times for you. If we can get my husband free. Yeah. And I pray that it impacts your heart as much as it impacted mine. And I pray that as you go along your week, you're going to hear this song in your mind. And every time the enemy tries to tell you that you're alone, I pray that this song resonates and rings in your heart, in your spirit, and in your soul. Is this off? We got to turn this off. Okay, we're ready. God, I tell you, how can you not come to church? It's so much fun. Praise the Lord. Would you stand with me as we close in prayer? I pray that every single one of you is encouraged in the Lord. That it doesn't matter what you've gone through in parenting your own child. It doesn't matter where you are in your walk. That God's plan for us is to be a village. We got to uphold each other. We got to edify each other. We got to build each other up. We got to encourage each other. And we got to stand arm in arm as we come against the enemy whose sole purpose is just to destroy families, especially in this day and age. Amen? With every eye closed and every head bowed. If you're here this morning and maybe you've never given your heart to the Lord and you don't know that you're a part of the family of God, you don't know that you're a part of the village, but you want to be a part of the village. With every eye closed and every head bowed, we want to give you an opportunity to put your faith in Christ and join the family of God. Would you raise your hand? We want to pray for you. I see you. You can put your hand down. I see you. Anybody else? We'll wait for you. If you want to join the family of God today, I see you. Hallelujah. I see you. With every eye closed, would you repeat this? Everybody, would you repeat this after me? Say, Heavenly Father, thank you that you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to die for me, to forgive me of my sins, so that I could now be a part of the family of God. Lord, thank you that you've given me a divine village to belong to. I now choose to live for you and your glory in your village. Father, help me to connect to the family of God that you have given to me today. In Jesus' name I pray. With every eye closed and every head bowed, if you're here today and you're struggling in any area of your family life, whether it's in your marriage, whether it's in parenting your children, if you're struggling, would you raise your hand? I want to pray an impartation over you. Hallelujah. Hands everywhere. You put your hands down. Heavenly Father, I come to you in the mighty name of Jesus, and I thank and I praise you, Father God, for the village that raises the children, for the village that raises the families, for the village that raises the house of God. I pray, Father God, a special impartation of the Holy Spirit over every family that's here, that they would know beyond a shadow of a doubt that they do not walk alone, that you go before you, and that you are sending angel armies on the way to do battle for them. Father, I pray that they would open up their hearts to two or three people and allow for those people to walk with them, to journey with them, to empower them, to encourage them, to build up, to build them up, to pray with them, Father God. Father, I pray that you would open doors into this village. I pray that every person would be welcomed here. I pray that every person would experience your agapeo love. I pray that they would create genuine relationships, deep relationships, Father God. And Father, I pray against any condemnation that may come from the enemy because somebody has a child that's wayward. Father, we come against it. We rebuke it in the name of Jesus. And we know, Abba, that your hand is upon every single one of those children, that you will be faithful to win that battle till the end, Father. You will continue to battle for them until the day when Jesus returns and defeats the enemy once and for all. So we commit the families to you in your Son's precious name. We receive our victory in Jesus' name. And all of God's children said, amen, amen, and amen. Would you give the Lord a hand clap? Hallelujah. And I'm going to, if you made a decision for the Lord today for the first time, and or even if you're rededicating your life, I want you to go to the back, and we have a free gift for you. It's back there. Creighton, can you wave, Creighton? Right there at that table. We have a gift for you at that table. So if you made a decision for Jesus, just go back there and grab your gift. And then I'm going to invite all the cakey to come forward. It's children's church time. Come on, we're going to sing for Jesus. Here we go.
Pretty bright new round that is going down, cause our God is great and greatly to be praised.